Thanks to the new RDNA 3 APUs from AMD, mini PCs are getting to the point where they can hold up as small form factor gaming PCs that can handle AAA games and almost any emulator that you can throw at them. Hello everyone, Taki here. It took longer than I thought, but we finally have new Ryzen mini PCs with RDNA 3 GPUs, and in this video, we're going to take a look at the first one to reach mass production status. This is the new GTR7 from Beelink, and it should be one of the most powerful mini PCs from this generation with a stock TDP of 65 watts. Let's get this thing out of the package to get a closer look. This is the first time that I've used a mini PC from this company, but I'm digging the rectangular form factor. On the front, we have two USB ports. One is a USB 3.2 port, but they didn't give the specs of the Type-C. The back has a lot more. We have two USB 2.0 ports, two USB 3.2 ports, two USB 4.0 ports, HDMI, DisplayPort, and dual 2.5G LAN. We don't see a lot of innovation in the mini PC market, but they have a cool addition here with a MagSafe connector on the bottom for power delivery. I was kind of apprehensive about how this would work, but it works pretty nicely, even though you probably won't need to mess with it that often. That just leaves us with the fingerprint combo power button on the top. This is a quick way to log into Windows if you're using Windows Hello, and it's a nice touch if you plan to keep this close to your keyboard. Before we start doing anything else, I want to take a look at the inside of this because this style is slightly different from all of the mini PCs that I'm used to. This one is rectangular and it has a pretty cool design. I'm curious to see what we're working with here and what we can upgrade. With this back shell off, we can see that they've added a separator here. This is not common at all. This little fan is just to cool the SSD and Wi-Fi card. I don't think I've ever seen active cooling for an SSD in the mini PCs that I've reviewed. This is pretty sick. For a second, I thought this was the only fan in the entire thing, but we should have a pretty big one if this thing can go up to 65 watt TDP. Let's remove the final screw so we can take a look at the main fan. This thing has a pretty hefty copper heatsink on the front with some copper pipes under it. They told me not to remove this because it might damage the vapor chamber under it, so I'm gonna leave this as stock. If the temps are bad, I might consider doing a thermal paste swap later on. But overall, I'm digging the industrial design in this. Now it's time to do a first boot. I don't want to spend too long on this, but I did just want to say that the BIOS on this is pretty open. It's not the most open that I've seen, but it's definitely not locked down. I have this connected to a wireless HDMI screen that you saw at the beginning of the video right now, and I'm going through the setup process for Windows. I usually get questions about if these mini PCs come with games already installed, and they don't. Everything that you're going to see in this video was added by me. I've been really looking forward to testing out mini PCs with this chip because I want to see if it will line up with the tests that I've done on handhelds with this processor series. So with a 65 watt TDP cap, I was able to get 3256 overall with a pretty high CPU score. I ran a test again with a 100 megahertz overclock on the GPU, and that brought my previous score up to 2920, but it also lowered my CPU score a bit. I then did a 200 megahertz overclock, and it didn't really change the score, but I think I could get this improved if I ran it again. The last test that I ran was with the GPU at 3.2 gigahertz, and that gave me the best performance on this board. After doing the TimeSpy testing, I settled with an 85 watt TDP cap, and that gave me the best CPU performance that I've seen in this processor with a single core score of 1908. This thing is pretty nuts when it comes to the OpenCL score. I got 43,000, and when it comes to Vulkan, I got just a bit under 41,000, which is a lot higher than the 35,000 that I got on the iNeo 2S. Based on the benchmarks, I'm expecting great performance from this PC. Let's now test a collection of PC games to see how it holds up with real-world performance. I started my testing with Cyberpunk 2077 at 720p, but we were well over 60fps, so I jumped up to 1080p, and I decided to use that resolution for all of the games in this video to really test this thing. As you can see, our TDP goes up pretty high with this new TDP cap, but we're running smoothly at just under 60 frames per second at around 80 watt TDP. It fluctuates based on what we're doing, but this is great performance for Cyberpunk 2077 without FSR enabled. I do want to point out that if we did enable FSR, we would definitely be over 60 FPS. However, I'm more interested in what this APU can do without using options like that, so I went with 1080p and the lowest settings possible without using resolution scaling or FSR. The GPU can overclock higher than 3 GHz based on my testing, but it doesn't improve things for this title. We would need a bit more power to get this to run at a solid 60 FPS, but this is kind of nuts for an APU like this. even in combat here, we're still getting great performance. The next title that I wanted to take a look at is Borderlands 3. This is a title that runs better on RDNA 3 GPUs, and it's one that I've been running on gaming handhelds for a while now. By default, the game will boot up the first time with DirectX 11, and we're getting good performance here, but we really want to run this on DirectX 12. I just wanted to show you the difference that we can get if we just switch over to DirectX 12. Once we're on DirectX 12, we're getting about a 10 FPS increase in our average FPS. In combat, when there's a lot of action happening, our frame rate will dip, but it's usually staying around 60 FPS, which is really good to see in a semi-modern AAA game at 1080p low settings. I think depending on where you are in this game, you could bump up the resolution or the graphics settings, but we're fine with this level of performance on this mini PC. Doom Eternal is a game that I showcased in my previous performance reviews of this processor series. The big difference here is that we're running this game at 1080p nightmare settings with no resolution scaling and all graphics settings maxed out. It's running great on this mini PC. We're up to 80 watts on the TDP, and our GPU is overclocked to 3 GHz, but we probably don't need an overclock to run this game that well. I do see some screen tearing while I'm playing this, but I did just want to show what the uncapped FPS looks like. Spider-Man Remastered was another game that I wanted to take a look at since I've showed it off on other Phoenix APU videos. I went back and forth with the settings on this one. I was able to use the low preset with no resolution scaling and no FSR, and that gave me really good performance. When we're indoors, we have decent reflections on the floor at 60 FPS, but in the city, we don't quite hit 60 FPS, but we're pretty close. It's gonna depend a lot on what we're doing and how busy the area is that we're in. We're gonna go down to like 49 FPS, but this is still great performance. You could turn on FSR to quality and you'd be at 60 all day. So it just comes down to personal preference, but I think this looks great even without hitting 60 FPS. Final Fantasy XV is kind of similar to Spider-Man Remastered in that we get about the same performance on the low preset. We're closer to 60 frames per second in some areas, and we can even get that in combat, like the scene that you're watching right now. However, when it comes to scenarios where we're in open world and there's a lot of monsters, we don't quite hit 60 FPS. We'll see dips down into the 40s, which is kind of crazy to see that we can't even max out this game with the very high GPU overclock and our TDP limit. The next game is Control. Let's take a look at the settings and play around with them a bit to get the best performance possible. We're currently at low settings with a couple of things turned off, but that's enough for us to get 60. I had to turn on VSync because this game has some really bad tearing when you're turning the camera around a lot. So just know that 60 FPS is not the best performance that you can get with these settings. Shadow of the Tomb Raider is another game that runs better on RDNA 3 GPUs. I'm using the low preset right now without any other changes. We would be able to go over 60 FPS in some of these scenes, but I turn on VSync to help with the screen tearing. Generally, you will be around 60 FPS with these settings.
Something's not right.
Our last game is Horizon Zero Dawn. For this, we're going to use custom settings and set everything to the lowest possible to show you what you can expect in a worst case scenario. This means no FSR or any upscaling. Again, we have a very high TDP cap with the GPU overclocked, and we're getting around 40 to 45 FPS. It's not bad, but I've seen claims that this game can run above 60 FPS, which is not something that's gonna happen at 1080p or any higher resolutions with this GPU. If we went in and set FSR to ultra quality with everything else being the same, that would give us just under 60 FPS. The only problem is that FSR at 1080p with low settings doesn't look that great, so I tend to not use that option. And here's what it looks like with that off.
Stay still. Wait for it to pass. Now keep low.
We're gonna wrap up this video with some emulation. Emulation on this processor is pretty good. It can do pretty much everything that's out there right now for emulation with varying degrees of success. As you get closer to the high end with GameCube and Wii, you're gonna be able to run those perfectly with the Dolphin emulator. Even PlayStation 2 games that are upscaled aren't an issue on this mini PC. Here we are with God of War 2 running at 60 FPS. Vita emulation is as flawless as ever with the Vita 3K emulator. I'm not really sure what more you could want from this emulator at this point. It's got the whole creepypasta thing going on at a locked 30 FPS. 3DS emulation is much better now, and compatibility is a lot higher than Vita 3K. You'll probably want to stick with the Vulkan backend going forward on AMD GPUs, as that will run a lot better. However, we're having no problems here with upscaled 3DS. Now it's time for some Xbox emulation. Here is Xbox with the XMU emulator. This thing is taking advantage of our pretty good CPU performance, and these games are running almost flawlessly. Wii U is a very easy system to emulate, and we don't really need the performance of this processor to play these games, but we could probably use the additional performance if we wanted to render some of these games in 4K. At 1080p, you're gonna be all set. Xbox 360 emulation is performing better all the time. This emulator has received a lot of updates that allows it to run a lot better on AMD APUs, like the one that's inside this mini PC. Here we are with Red Dead Redemption, and it's running really great at a locked 30 frames per second. And just so we have a second title, here's Fable 2, also running very well. PS3 emulation is where you'll really see the performance increase from Ryzen 6000 to Ryzen 7000. A lot of the games for this platform are gonna take advantage of the new CPU. For our first game, here's Ratchet & Clank. It does fluctuate a bit, but it's running very well overall. And just as a second game, this is one that used to be used a lot for benchmarking, but it's not really a demanding game anymore. I only included it in this video for that transition. So yeah, that's the GTR7 from Beelink. As I said, this is the first time that I've used a product from this company, so I wasn't sure what to expect. I think it's cool that this thing supports such a high overclock and a high TDP ceiling. They have a more expensive configuration than the one that I used in this video with a slightly better processor, but I think that one is kind of pointless given that we can achieve the same performance by pushing the TDP and the GPU clocks on this one. I'll also point out that this one does have the ability to run from a Type-C cable connected to the USB 4.0 ports if you ever end up damaging or losing the proprietary connector that this comes with. The only other thing that stood out to me while I was making this is just how quiet the mini PC is. Even with the overclock that I used and the high TDP cap, this thing doesn't really make a lot of noise, so if that's something that's important to you, this might be one to consider. But that's gonna wrap up things on this one. If you enjoyed this video, take a look at my ROG Ally First Impressions video. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.